La Fille du Régiment. The opera was written by Donizetti while he was living in Paris between 1838 and 1840, preparing a revised version of his then unperformed Italian opera, Polyeucto, as Les Martyrs for the Paris Opera. Since Martyrs was delayed, the composer had time to write the music for La Fille, his first opera set to a French text, as well as to stage the French version of Lucia di Lammermoor as Lucie de Lammermoor. As La Fille, it quickly became a popular success, partly because of the famous aria Messe Amis, Caligiura de Fate, which requires of the tenor no fewer than 9 high Cs. A slightly different Italian language version, in translation by Callisto Bossi, was adapted to the tastes of the Italian public. The opening night was a barely averted disaster. Apparently the lead tenor was frequently off pitch. The noted French tenor Gilbert Dupré, who was present, later observed in his Souvenirs d'un Chanteur, Donizetti often swore to me how his self-esteem as a composer had suffered in Paris. He was never treated there according to his merits. I myself saw the unsuccess, almost the collapse, of La Fille du Régiment. It received a highly negative review from the French critic and composer Hector Berlioz, Journal des Debats, February 16, 1840, who claimed it could not be taken seriously by either the public or its composer, although Berlioz did concede that some of the music, the little waltz that serves as the entr'acte and the trio dialogue, lack neither vivacity nor freshness. The source of Berlioz's hostility is revealed later in his review. The critic and poet Théophile Gautier, who was not a rival composer, had a somewhat different point of view. Monsieur, Donizetti is capable of paying with music that is beautiful and worthy for the cordial hospitality which France offers him in all her theatres, subsidized or not. Despite its bumpy start, the opera soon became hugely popular at the Opera Comique. During its first 80 years, it reached its 500th performance at the Théâtre in 1871 and its 1000th in 1908. The opera was first performed in Italy at La Scala, Milan, on October 3, 1840, in Italian with recitatives by Donizetti replacing the spoken dialogue. It was thought worthless and received only 6 performances. It was not until 1928 when Totti Dal Monte sang Marie that the opera began to be appreciated in Italy. La Fille received its first performance in America on March 7, 1843 at the Théâtre d'Orléans in New Orleans. The New Orleans company premiered the work in New York City on July 19, 1843 with Julie Calvet as Marie. The Spirit of the Times, 22nd of July, counted it a great success, and, although the score was thin and not up to the level of Anna Bolena or L'Elisir d'Amore, some of Donizetti's gems were to be found in it. The Herald, 21st of July, was highly enthusiastic, especially in its praise of Calvet. Applause is an inadequate term, vehement cheering rewarded this talented prima donna. Subsequently the opera was performed frequently in New York, the role of Marie being a favorite with Jenny Lind, Henriette Sontag, Pauline Luca, Anna Thielen, and Adelina Patti. First given in England in Italian, it appeared on May 27, 1847 at Her Majesty's Theatre in London, with Jenny Lind and Luigi Laplace. Later, on December 21, 1847 in English, it was presented at the Surrey Theatre in London. W. S. Gilbert wrote a burlesque adaptation of the opera, La Vivendière, in 1867. The Metropolitan Opera gave the first performances with Marcella Sembrich and Charles Guilbert, Sulpice, during the 1902-03 season. It was then followed by performances at the Manhattan Opera House in 1909 with Luisa Tetrazzini, John McCormack, and Charles Guilbert, and again with Frieda Hempel and Antonio Scotti in the same roles at the Met on December 17, 1917. It was revived at the Royal Opera, London, in 1966 for Joan Sutherland. On February 13, 1970, in concert at Carnegie Hall, Beverly Sills sang the first performance in New York since Lily Pons performed it at the Metropolitan Opera House in 1943. This opera is famous for the aria, sometimes referred to as, which has been called the Mount Everest for tenors. It features 9 high Cs and comes comparatively early in the opera, giving the singer less time to warm up his voice. Luciano Pavarotti's stardom is reckoned from a performance alongside Joan Sutherland at the Met, when he leapt over the Becker's brook of the string off high Cs with an aplomb that left everyone gasping. More recently, Juan Diego Flores performed at La Scala, and then, on popular demand, repeated it, breaking a 74-year embargo on encores at the legendary Milanese Opera House. He repeated this feat on April 21, 2008, the opening night of the 2007 London production at the Met, with Nathalie Desaye as Marie. This Met production was broadcast in high-definition video to movie theaters worldwide on April 26, 2008. As a non-singing role, the Duchess of Craigenthorpe is often played by non-operatic celebrities, who have included actresses such as Dawn French, Bea Arthur, and Hermione Gingold, as well as retired opera greats such as Kiri Takanawa and Montserrat Caballé. In 2016, U.S. Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, a lifelong opera fan, played the Duchess on opening night of the Washington National Opera's production. Today, the opera is frequently performed to the point that it has become part of the standard repertoire. The opera was filmed in a silent film in 1929, a sound film with Annie Oldre in 1933 in German and separately in French, in 1953, and in 1962 with John Bancasterine as Tonio. Fighting is raging in the Tyrols, and the Marquis of Birkenfeld, who is traveling in the area, is alarmed to the point of needing smelling salts to be administered by her faithful steward, Hortensius. While a chorus of villagers express their fear, the Marquis does the same. Pour une femme de mon âme, for a lady of my family, what a time, alas, is wartime. As the French can be seen to be moving away, all express their relief. Suddenly, and provoking the fear of the remaining women who scatter, Sergeant Sulpice of the 21st Regiment of the French Army, in the Italian version it is the 11th, arrives and assures everyone that the regiment will restore order. Marie, the vivandière, canteen girl, of the regiment, enters, and Sulpice is happy to see her. Duet, Sulpice and Marie, mais, qui vient? Dion, Marie, notre fille, but who is this? Well, well, if it isn't our daughter Marie, then, as he questions her about a young man she has been seen with, she identifies him as Tonio, a Tyrolean, in the Italian version, Swiss. At that moment, Tonio is brought in as a prisoner, because he has been seen prowling around camp. Marie saves him from the soldiers, who demand that he must die, by explaining that he had saved her life when she nearly fell while mountain climbing. All toast Tonio, who pledges allegiance to France, and Marie is encouraged to sing the regimental song, aria, chacun le sait, chacun le dit, everyone knows it, everyone says it. Sulpice leads the soldiers off, taking Tonio with him, but he runs back to join her. She quickly tells him that he must gain the approval of her fathers, the soldiers of the regiment, who found her on the battlefield as an abandoned baby, and adopted her. Skeptical as to why Tonio has returned, he proclaims his love for her, aria, then love duet with Marie, depuis l'instant où, dans mes bras, ever since that moment when you fell and, I caught you, all trembling in my arms, and then the couple express their love for each other. At that point, Sulpice returns, surprising the young couple who leave. The Marquise arrives with Hortensius, initially afraid of the soldier, but is calmed by him. The Marquise explains that they are trying to return to her castle and asks for an escort. When hearing the name Birkenfeld, Sulpice immediately recognizes it from a letter found with Marie as an infant. It is discovered that the Marquise's long-lost niece is actually Marie, who returns and is surprised to be introduced to her aunt. The Marquise commands that Marie accompany her and that she will be taught to be a proper lady. Marie bids farewell to her beloved regiment just as Tonio enters, proclaiming that he has enlisted in their ranks, aria, ah. Mes amis, quel jour de fête, ah, my friends, what an exciting day. In proclaiming his love for Marie, the soldiers are horrified, but agree to his pleading for her hand. However, they tell him that she is about to leave with her aunt, Marie, aria, il faut partir, I must leave you. In a choral finale in which all join, she leaves with the Marquise and Tonio is enraged. Marie has been living in the Marquise's castle for several months. In a conversation with Sulpice, the Marquise describes how she has sought to modify most of her military manners and make her into a lady of fashion, suitable for her to be married to her nephew, the Duke of Croquenthorpe. Although reluctant, Marie has agreed and Sulpice is asked to encourage her. Marie enters and is asked to play the piano, but appears to prefer more martial music when encouraged by Sulpice and sings the regimental song. The Marquise sits down at the piano and attempts to work through the piece with Maria, who becomes more and more distracted and, along with Sulpice, takes up the regimental song. Marie is left alone, aria, parla rang at parlo palans, they have tried in vain to dazzle me. As she is almost reconciled to her fate, she hears martial music, and is joyously happy, cabaletta, oh. Transport. Oh. Deuce of res, oh bliss. Oh ecstasy, and the regiment arrives. With it is Tonio, now an officer. The soldiers express their joy at seeing Marie, and Marie, Tonio and Sulpice are joyfully reunited, although he tries to tell her something she does not know but is ignored. Trio, Marie, Sulpice, Tonio, too late Warianni, we three are reunited. The Marquise enters, horrified to see soldiers. Tonio asks for Marie's hand, explaining that he risked his life for her. Aria, Tonio, pour me rapproché de Marie, Jamie and Roy, pauvre soldat, in order to woo Marie, I enlisted in the ranks, but she dismisses him scornfully. Tonio and Marie leave separately, and the Marquise confesses the truth to Sulpice. Marie is her own illegitimate daughter. In the circumstances, Sulpice promises that Marie will agree to her mother's wishes. The Duchess and her nephew arrive and Marie enters with Sulpice, who has given her the news that the Marquise is her mother. Marie embraces her and decides she must obey. But at the last minute the soldiers of the regiment storm in. Chorus, soldiers, then Tonio, Osacorse de Notre Fille, our daughter needs our help, and it is revealed that Marie was a canteen girl. Indignantly, the Duchess leaves, but the other guests are impressive when Marie sings of her debt to the soldiers. Aria, Marie, Conladestin, Omelia de la Guerre, when fate, in the confusion of war, threw me, a baby, into their arms. The Marquise is deeply moved, admits she is Marie's mother, and gives her consent to Marie and Tonio, amid universal rejoicing. Final chorus, Salut à la France. Hurrah for France. For happy times. Notes cited sources. Other sources. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.